We got down through about verse number 42. I want to start in verse 41 tonight. And we're right here in the middle of Christ is facing the cross. He's on the way to be betrayed by Judas. He's in the Garden of Gethsemane. And he's been praying. He took the eight disciples and he says, you know, pray, stay. And he took the three, Peter, James, and John, a little further along, said, pray for him. And then he went away, went further on, and he prays, if it's possible for this cup pass, nevertheless, not my will, but thy be done. He comes back the first two times, and they're all asleep. And verse 41, he cometh the third time. So he's gone, prayed three times. Now he's coming back that third time and said unto them, sleep on now. Take your rest. It is enough. The hour is come. Behold, the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise up, let us go. He that betrayeth me is at hand. And verse 41 is a verse that kind of shows you the shepherd. You remember back in verse number 27, he said to the disciples, all ye that shall be offended because of me this night, for it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered. And what he's doing in the passage is he's demonstrating the sheep scattering. They immediately say, no, we'll stick with you. And he says, yeah, just you watch. The scripture knows best. And so you begin to see them scattering and not resisting the temptation. And so after they've failed to pray twice and the third time, this time when he comes back, he doesn't heap guilt on them. He doesn't rebuke them. He doesn't try to shame them for their failure. He's already said they're going to smite the shepherd and the sheep are going to scatter. What he's going to do here is he's going to demonstrate that he's still the shepherd. And in spite of the sheep scattering, which is what they should not do, he's still going to be the one who's going to shepherd them. So when he says, and it's kind of an odd twist, before he said, couldn't you, you know, you're asleep, couldn't you pray with me for 1 hour? And yet here he says, sleep on now and take your rest. It's like he understands that the things that are going on with them have caused them a great deal of turmoil. If you look over, just hold your hand and look over in Luke 22, it's interesting how he says it there. Luke chapter 22. Verse number 45. And when he rose up from prayer and came to his disciples, he found them sleeping for sorrow and said unto them, why? He understands that they're sleeping really for sorrow, the overheaviness of their sorrow for what's going on. They're emotionally exhausted. There's a lot of things going on in these passages that when you just especially when you read Mark, Mark just goes from one event to the next event to the next event, and he doesn't really give you time to think about all the stuff going. He's connecting all the events together. Matthew and Luke and John kind of back up and give you some of the commentary about what's going on. And so when they're asleep, now he says, sleep on, take your rest. He obviously understands that they're exhausted. And he's telling them, go ahead and go ahead and rest. It's okay. They have slept because of their dullness of hearing. They weren't getting things. But now it's time, you know, he wants them to rest. It's interesting, he's watching while they're sleeping. There's the shepherd. Then he says to them, it is enough. You see the colon after rest? Take your rest. Now, the next thing, it's enough. The hour has come. When he says it's enough, it's like, all right, guys, it's time to get up. You've rested. Now, you've rested enough because the betrayer is coming. It's time to get up and let's get going. So now he's going to move. The rest is over. Let's go. He lets them rest until it's time to go. So instead of berating them, instead of, you know, haranguing them, Just get you some rest because tough times are coming. And so he's the shepherd kind of watching over them. So rising up, verse 42, let us go. Lo, he that betrayeth me is at hand. And immediately. So if you ever wanted to know what at hand means, that the term the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The Lord is at hand. That term at hand can be used in a lot of different ways. In this context, he that betrayeth me is at hand, and immediately, while he yet spake. In other words, it's right here going on now. So at hand doesn't have to mean way off in the future. It means something that's near. It's like the term, we had our family together. Rick was here, and David and Jody and his family came over for supper to eat with their Uncle Rick, who they don't see very often. He lives in Arizona. And, you know, we've got my wife spread this big table, all sitting there. And I said, would you hand me the butter? And they look, it's at hand. It's right there. When something is at hand, it's within your grasp. I couldn't get it, but somebody else, and they hand it to me. Well, that's the idea of the term at hand. It's something that's near. In this case, it's while he yet spake. So it's not a long way off. It's immediately. And immediately while he yet spake, cometh Judas, one of the 12, with him, and with him a great multitude with swords and staves from the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. And he that betrayeth him had given them a token, saying, whomsoever I shall kiss, the same is he. Take him and lead him away safely. And as soon as he was come, he goeth straightway to him and said, Master, Master, and kissed him. And they laid their hands on him and took him. So Mark is giving you the betrayal and the arrest, the skinny of it. It just boom, boom, there it is. Whomsoever I shall kiss, that same is he. Take him, lead him away. That's the kiss of betrayal, it's known as, the kiss off. And that's Judas's legacy. And Mark doesn't cloak that. He doesn't garb it with any kind of frivolousness. He doesn't try to take the treachery. Somebody said it's treachery cloaked in the garb of affection. But it's certainly Judas's legacy. It's fascinating when you compare Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John about this account. And I just want you to do that with me just for a minute. When Mark does it, it's just boom, boom, boom. Mark presents the efficiency of a servant. Remember, Mark's looking at it like he's the servant. So you just got the facts of you're not interested in stuff about the servant, so can he get the job done? What's happening? That's what's in Mark. But look back at Matthew 26. Because Matthew, when he does it, it's not different. It's just it's more elaborate. Matthew 26, verse number 47. And while he yet spake, lo, Judas, one of the 12, came, and with him a great multitude, with swords and staves, from the chief priests and elders of the people. Now he that betrayed him gave them a sign, saying, whomsoever I shall kiss, that same is he. Behold, hold him fast. And forthwith he came to Jesus and said, Hail, Master, and kissed him. Now, Mark, he just says, Master. Matthew says, Hail. Matthew is going to present Christ as the king. So when he comes to, he gives a royal address, as it were. He's going to present him with the formality of a Hail. And he calls him, he says, unto him, Friend, wherefore art thou come? Well, he's my own familiar friend has kicked up his heel against me. That's the title that the psalm gave him. But when Jesus says, Friend, that's really the judgment of the king. Because Judas could have been his friend. Come with me to John chapter 15. That's what Judas is in the betrayal. What he's doing, the judgment of the betrayal on Judas is he's losing the opportunity to be friend. And Christ looking at him, giving him the opportunity, friend. Well, John chapter number 15, verse 13. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends. Now, he's in the upper room with his apostles. This is just right before they went into the garden. Ye are my friends, if you do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth, and think about that. He calls Judas friend. But how are you his friend? You do his word. You do what he commanded. Henceforth, verse 15, I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth. But I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. So they've been given the word. They have the opportunity to be friends. But if you look back at chapter 13, John 13, verse number 26. Here he's with all 12. They're in the upper room. John 13, verse 26. Jesus said, he it is to whom I shall give a sop when I have dipped it. And when he had dipped the sop, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. And after the sop, Satan entered into him. Then said Jesus unto him, that which thou doest, do quickly. Now no man in the table knew for what intention he spake this unto him. For some of them thought, because Judas had the bag, that Jesus had said unto him, buy those things that you have need of against the feast, or that he should give something to the poor. He, that is Judas, then having received the sop, went immediately out, and it was night. So Judas leaves the group to go betray him, gather the crowd. The next two chapters later, in the same conversation, in the same room, with the same group, this time only the 11 apostles, he calls them friends. So Judas has lost he was gone when Christ told him that, because he's not going to do by faith what God gave him to do. So what you have in Matthew is, none of that's in Mark, because Mark's just the servant. But Matthew is more, you're getting more of the king in judgment and the pronouncements about people's status. Come with me to the book of Luke. When Luke does this, Luke and John are even more so. In Luke chapter 22, I'm sorry, verse number 47. While he yet spake, behold, a multitude, and he that was called Judas, one of the 12, went before them and drew near unto Jesus to kiss him. And Jesus said unto him, Judas, betrayest thou the Son of Man with a kiss? Luke says, you're betraying the Son of Man. Well, who is it that Luke presents the Messiah as? The man. Behold the man. So Luke presents him as a man, and Christ addresses Judas, he's calling the attention to the fact that you're betraying the Son of Man. Now, that Son of Man title is a prophetic title about the Messiah, who's going to be God in human flesh. But the emphasis is on the man, our humanity. If you come over to John, the book of John, the emphasis is on his deity. And in John 18, the betrayal of Christ, this is the most flamboyant, maybe I should say, of the accounts. In fact, this one almost, in John's account, Judas is sort of like a bit actor. He's not even significant. He's just there. And it's all the other stuff that Jesus does. Because here's God. Now, here's God dealing with the betrayal. John 18. And when Jesus had spoken these words, he went forth with his disciples over the brook Chedron, where was a garden, into which he entered and his disciples. Now, that's when he goes in and they pray the three times. So now he's in the garden, he's prayed, let this cup pass, nevertheless not my will, but thy will be done. And he has resolved that issue. He comes out, verse number 2, and Judas also, which betrayed him, knew the place, for Jesus often resorted there with his disciples. This was a place where Jesus often, once you go through the accounts, you'll see that he goes to the Mount of Olives and he prays and so forth. And Judas knew where he'd be. Judas then, having received a band of men and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, cometh thither with lanterns and torches and weapons. In verse number 2, or verse number 4, I'm sorry, Jesus therefore, knowing all things that should come upon him, went forth and said unto them, whom seek ye? Now notice how that says that. You read over that too quickly and you miss it. The Lord Jesus Christ knows when I leave this garden, I'm going to be betrayed. He knows exactly what's going to happen to him. And then the verse says he went forth. The sense of victory, of a mind that's set on a purpose. He knows exactly what's going to happen. But there's no trace of any of the hesitancy, if it be thy will. He's settled that. And now he's got that gait of someone who is committed completely and fully, without any question, to know exactly, not just what the Father's will is, but I'm going to do that. You sit down in verse number 11. Then said Jesus unto Peter, put up thy sword into the sheath. The cup which my Father hath given me. There's none of that, if it be thy will. Is there another way to do this? That's resolved. The Father's given. He's going to the cross. He's going to accomplish the Father's will. And there's no question in all of that. So he goes forth, and he goes forth as the conquering hero. And so what happens? He says, whom seek ye? Now, Judas has already betrayed him. But none of that's in there. In John, Judas is a bit player. You only read about him in verse number 3. So after Judas betrays him, Christ looks at the crowd and says, who are you guys looking for? Verse 5, they answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus said unto them, I am he. You see that I am he, you see that he is in italics. In the language he was speaking, he just said, I am. Now, I am is an incomplete sentence, so you have to add the he in order to make it a complete sentence. That's that Jehovah title. Jehovah in the Bible, the I am, you go back to John 8, he says, before Abraham was, I am. The Lord Jesus Christ is Jehovah God the Son. You have the Jehovah titles, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha, and so forth. And those names you take, I am, and then fill in the blank. And here he's saying, I am Jehovah. And when he does that, and Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with them, and as soon as he had said unto them, I am he, they went backwards and fell to the ground. Whew. So John is pointing out the fact that this is God himself who's being betrayed. But more than that, this is God himself who is going to surrender himself to be betrayed. Verse number 7. They ask him, then ask he them again, whom seek ye? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. This religious mob, you see how it says that they came out with sticks and staves and a multitude, and they've got these religious leaders and so forth. This is a mob who are in riot gear. Now you're going to see in Mark in a minute, he's going to challenge them about that. But it's a mob action sent from the government in riot gear to take this one person. And he says, I'm he, and whew, they're all back on their fannies. He gets up, says it again, and the same result. I don't know about you, but I'd figure after two times, you know, one time I'd be hesitant, two times I'd be heading home. But religious bigotry and religious blindness doesn't allow them to do that. Verse 8, Jesus said, I have told you that I am he. If therefore you seek me, let these go their way. There again, here's the shepherd looking to protect the sheep. That the saying might be fulfilled. Everything in the mind of Christ is that the scripture be fulfilled. Which he said, of them which thou gavest me, I have lost none. But Simon Peter, and this at this point, I'll save this part of it for a little later, but I just notice what Peter does. He draws out a sword and smote the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. So Peter is still in the mode of trying to protect the Lord, who's just demonstrated that he can protect himself with a word. Okay? So in each of the gospel accounts, come back to Mark now, in each one of them, this event is portrayed in a way as to demonstrate the character of the epistle, of the letter, the account that's there. Matthew, he's the king, hail. Mark, he's the servant, boom, boom, it's there. Luke, he's the man, he's betraying the Son of Man. And John, he's God, and nobody, you're betraying him, but I'm telling you, I'm him, and you can't take me if I don't let you. See how that emphasis in each one of them. Then go back to Mark chapter 14. Verse 45, and as soon as he was come, he goes straightway to him and said, Master, Master, and kissed him. Notice when it says, Master, Master. Hold your hand and come with me back to John. I should have told you to hold on to that. Chapter 13. Something Jesus told him in the upper room. Now this is before Judas leaves. John 13:13. Ye, and he's talking to the 12, call me Master and Lord. And you say, well, for so I am. Judas never called Jesus Christ Lord. He always said Master. Here he emphasizes Master, Master. Judas never was someone who was a man of faith in who the Lord Jesus Christ was. So he says, Master, Master, and he kissed him, and they laid hands on him and took him. Now the they is verse 43. So who took him? With him, verse 43, a great multitude. In other words, there's this mob of people with swords and staves. They're in their riot gear. Where'd they come from? The chief priests and scribes and elders, John said, and the Pharisees. It's the religious leaders, verse 53, and they led Jesus away to the high priest, and with him were assembled all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes. So when they got Jesus, they take hold of him, lay hands on him, took him, and then they lead him, and they take him to the high priest's house. And you've got the chief priests, the elders, the scribes, the Pharisees. They're all there waiting. They had sent these guys to get Christ, and now they're expecting him. They're waiting for him. They're ready for his coming. There's no attempt to dilute the guilt either of Judas or of the leaders of their crime. He lists them in verse 43, and does in the other text, the scribes, the chief priests, the elders, the Pharisees. He lists them because he lays the guilt of what's going on here right on their shoulders. And the nation, you remember Paul talks about the commonwealth of Israel? They were led by their leaders. And their leaders represented them as a top-down kind of a thing. And the leaders were the nation. So what's happening here is the leaders of the nation are betraying him. And there's no effort by the scripture, especially Mark, to dilute that in any way. Now, verse 47, one of them that stood by drew a sword. Now, we know that's Peter because of John 18. And smote a servant of the high priest and cut off his ear. Now, run back over with me to John 18 because there's something important here. Because when you get on down in the text there, verse 40, 54 in Mark says, Peter followed him afar off, even in the palace of into the palace of the high priest, and sat with the servants and warmed himself at the fire. And preachers like to talk about Peter warming himself at the devil's fire. And what preachers call Judas, I'm sorry, they tell you that Peter was a coward. Listen, Peter was never a coward. Pilate was the coward. Pilate said, I find no fault in him. His wife said, don't have anything to do with this innocent man. He says, here, I'm going to wash my hands of this. Pilate knew he was innocent, and because he's a coward who cowered at the political implications of what he's doing, Peter was never a coward. Peter was a commercial fisherman. And I said to you before, I don't know how much you know about commercial fishermen. I was born on the Gulf Coast. I've known commercial fishermen all my life. I have relatives who are commercial fishermen and who were commercial fishermen. If you're going to get on a boat and go out into the water and make your living, well, you're not going to be a coward. My uncle used to say, I'll fight at the drop of a hat, and if you aren't careful, I'll drop the hat. And that's the spirit of a commercial. That's Peter. He said, nobody's going to touch you, Lord. They got to come through me to get to you. But what happened? John 18, verse 10, Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it out. Now, Peter is going to defend the Messiah, his Lord, but he's going to use the wrong sword to do it. Christ has given him the word. He's got the sword of the Spirit, the instructions about what God's doing. Christ is telling him, here, we're going to fulfill these things. And Pete grabs, I got a sword. And he pulls it out, and he cut off the right ear of the high priest's servant. Now, interesting, it's the high priest's servant that's leading the crowd there. So the guilt is clear. But Peter cuts off his right ear. Now, you think about how do you cut somebody's right ear off with a sword? Well, if you're going to cut my right ear off and you're just going to chop me like that, you're going to hit my ear and cut my shoulder. But if you're going like this for my head and I duck, you get my ear. That's probably the way he did it. Peter's ready to fight. The ear goes up in the air, Christ catches it, and he reattaches it, and he heals him. And he says to Peter, put up thy sword into the sheath. The cup which my Father hath given me, shall I not drink it? Then the band and the captain of officers and of the Jews took Jesus and bound him and led him away. The one thing that Peter wasn't prepared for was to give up without a fight. Because he didn't know how to give up with that. That isn't Peter. He's willing to surrender his life, but he didn't understand that Christ was going to willfully, intentionally, voluntarily surrender. And you think about that. Come back with me to Mark chapter 8. In Mark chapter 8, Christ had told them he was going to die. They didn't understand it. They weren't listening. They were dull of hearing. Peter hadn't gotten the surrender without a fight concept. Mark chapter 8, verse number 31. And he began to teach them, Christ, that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders of the chief priests and scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. Now that's pretty clear. And he spake that saying openly. Matthew 16 says, he began to teach them. Verse 31, he began, this is the first time he began to say that, but he's doing it very plainly and openly. Luke 18 says they didn't understand it. It was hid from them. Verse 32, and he spake this saying openly, and Peter took him and began to rebuke him. That's Pete. You know, here's your Lord telling you what the Word of God says, and I'm going to go do it. And Pete says, man, that ain't right. But when he had turned about and looked on his disciples, this Jesus, he rebuked Peter, saying, get thee behind me, Satan. For thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of man. Pete, you're listening to the flesh. You're not listening to God's word. And he said, in verse 34, and when he had called his people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, now watch, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. If you're going to follow me, you're going to have a cross. You're going to have some rejection. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. Now, that's a concept Pete hadn't picked up on yet. In fact, he doesn't get it until Pentecost. But the concept is, if you want to save your life, you got to lose it. You'll have to surrender it to doing the will of God. And if you surrender yourself to doing what the Scripture says, then you'll really have real life, no other path. Well, Pete hadn't got that concept yet. And what's happening here is they're down to the moment where you've got to make the decision. If you're just a curious bystander, it's time to leave. Now, you're going to see that in a minute down in verse 51 and 52. That's exactly what happens with some. But right now, Pete, we've got to fish or cut bait. And right now, to obey God's word, I surrender. So for Peter, his reaction is not cowardice, it's bewilderment. It's confusion. It's not even fear. I don't think Peter had a fearful bone in his body. He was just mad, disillusioned. And when it says down in verse 54 that he followed from afar off, and he sat with the servants and warmed himself at the fire, he's in essence saying, "I'm all right, if you're going to give up and you're not even going to fight, well, I don't want." And then his heart gets him, and he follows. I'm just going to watch and see this thing out to the bitter end. And he does. In fact, after this, in John 21, he says, I'm going to go fishing. I'm going to go back to the old life. But he really follows Christ. There are two guys. Peter follows him in, and John is in there with him. In fact, when you read the book of John, the way Pete got in to the chief priest is John is in there and says, go get that guy and bring him in. So Pete comes in. But please don't accuse Peter of, don't ever accuse him of being a coward. Pilate was the coward from the word go. He's looking a way to sneak out. But Peter from the word go is looking for a way to fight. Let's fight. I'll protect you. I won't let anybody get you. And when Christ says, the cup the Father's given me, shouldn't I do God's will? And Peter's disillusionment at the moment, because he was still dull of hearing. Now, if you go back to verse 48, After all of that's taken place, before they take him away, Jesus addresses the crowd. Jesus answered, verse 48, and said unto them, "Are ye come out as against a thief with swords and with staffs to take me?" I don't know if you've seen on the internet the last couple of weeks, but there's a church up in Calgary, Alberta, that they've closed down, the government has, because of the COVID stuff. And they didn't close down. It's a church of 500-600 people. And instead of closing down, they've kept meeting. And finally, the government went in and shut them down. They put the preacher in jail for 35 days. And they put a fence around the church, did all this kind of stuff. Well, there's another church. This one's in British Columbia. And it's a Polish pastor. The church in Calgary actually is an American pastor. But this Polish pastor, there have been some YouTube videos that he's put on when he calls them the Nazi Gestapos, and they come, and they come during the church service, and they want to come in, and there's a health department official with an order for her to be able to come in and inspect the building, and there are at least 8 or 10 fully armed cops, Mounties or whatever they are, and they're armed with all the body armor and all that kind of stuff, the guns and so forth. And this preacher, he just gives them the dickens. It's really funny. He says, "You're not coming in. I'm not letting you in. Here you are," and he's talking to her, not the cops. "Here you are with your Gestapo," and the one yesterday that I was looking at, she's reading him. "Well, I have this court order," and he says. "That's, you got the wrong group. You don't go back and do your homework." and he withstands them. But my point is, here are the religious, the government trying to close this guy down. He stands against them, but you've got all these armed. I mean, what? And he says, what makes you think if you came on Monday and asked me to look at our building, I'd let you in and look at the building? But you don't want to look at the building. You want to intimidate my people. And you come in here with the cops, and you come in here with the sticks and the staffs, the guns and all that kind of stuff, and you've got your armored vehicle out in the street out there like we're... What makes you think you need to do that to us? You don't need to. It's intimidation. So what Christ does is he challenges them. You're going to come with all this kind of stuff? You really think you need that? Why would you think you needed that? You think I'm a thief? Well, I was with you daily in the temple, and you took me not. If you've been thinking I'm a thief, and you've been thinking I'm a robber, and you've been thinking you need the armed Gestapo to come get me, I've been with you talking in the temple. In fact, I just entered into Jerusalem. Some of you guys were sitting out there saying, "Hosanna, he that comes in the name of the Lord." And now, see, this is just a whole bunch of phony stuff. And he's calling out their hand. They're just completely out of place. They all knew who he was. They all knew he wasn't an evildoer. And they've come to take him on a pretense, use the government against him. "I was daily with you in the temple teaching you, and you took me not. But the scripture must be fulfilled." What's going on is God's word is being fulfilled. Therefore, he's going to surrender. Why? Because that's what the book says to do. Now, verse 50, "And they all forsook him." All the disciples forsook him. If you look back at verse 31, "But he," and that's Peter, "spake the more vehemently, If I should die with thee, I will not deny thee in any wise. Likewise also said they all." But when push came to shove, and the army's there, and the accusations are there, and obviously they're going to take him, they all forsake him. Now, I'm sure some of them forsook him out of fear. I know Peter forsook him out of frustration, disillusionment, and I kind of suspect the rest of them had some of that too. Now, verse 51 is a passage that is only found in Mark and is very confusing to people. And there followed him a certain young man having a linen cloth cast about his naked body. And the young men laid hold on him, and he left the linen cloth and fled from them naked. Now that account is only in the book of Mark. Consequently, all the commentaries and all the preachers that talk about this, they say, well, since this is only in Mark, it probably was Mark that was doing that. I'm going to tell you, that's just nonsense. That's what preachers say when they don't know what to say about something and they think they need to talk. And you hear somebody that you think is a good teacher say it, and then you just start repeating it. When you don't know what something is, in spite of who you've heard say something, best thing is just keep your mouth shut and think about it. Saturday when we were having the pastor's panel, Brother Des Stridham said something. I point because he was sitting right there. We were discussing teaching that people hear that they hear over the internet or whatever, and it's bad teaching. And they come to you and say, "But what do you think about what Brother So and So's teaching? And have you thought about what Brother and telling you about what somebody else teaches?" And he says, "I never talk to them about what Brother So." He says, "What do you think about that? What do you understand about that? What do you teach about that?" In other words, you need to be accountable for yourself, not what some. I'm not going to be accountable for what somebody else says through you. And what happens is people say, "You need to listen to so-and-so because he's right." Okay, teach me what's right. But if you can't teach me what's right, then you don't know what's right. You're just following a man. And until you've made it your own, then shove off. Well, that's what's happening here. Here's a young guy. Just look at what it says. They all forsook him. Now, here's a young guy, and there followed him a certain... So here's somebody who's following the Lord. But, you know, everybody that followed the Lord weren't real followers. There were some that were part of the true fellowship, and some that were just faking it till they make it. And you see them all through the life of Christ. Well, now you come to the point where it's time to make a decision. You go back over to Mark chapter 8. Look back over there just for a second. When he said what he did about verse 35, "Whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whosoever loses life for my sake and the gospel shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." There's a fish or cut bait time. And that fish or cut bait time in this context has to do with his suffering and his death. So when they come to take him, here's this young guy, verse 51, Mark 14, 51, "And there followed him a certain young man," and this is not Mark, "having a linen cloth cast about his naked body." Now, why in the world would you have a linen cloth cast about your naked body? Well, even in that day, you didn't walk around naked under your outer garment. Somebody's got this guy up and got him out before he had time to get dressed. If you want to put it like that. He's not properly dressed. He's there. He got dressed in a hurry. in haste. Well, if he's asleep and they wake him up, well, were there some people in Israel who were asleep and that the ministry of Christ and the disciples woke up? Sure. He fled. Now notice when he fled. The young men laid hold on him, and he left the little, he fled. So when it came time to be taken, for them to grab him and hold him, he runs. He had on linen cloth. By the way, look over at chapter 15. The linen cloth that he's talking about is burial clothes. Chapter 15, verse 46. Chapter 15, starting verse 45. And when he knew of it, that's Pilate, knew it of the centurion, he gave the body of Jesus to Joseph. And he brought fine linen and took him down and wrapped him in the linen and laid him in a sepulcher, which was hewn out of rock, and rolled a stone upon the door of the sepulcher. That linen, Matthew 26 calls it fine linen, 27 calls it fine linen, the same material that later on is used as burial garments for the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the stuff in John 20 when they're coming, they saw the linen lying. Here's a guy who is wrapped up, the commentary says night clothing, night garment, pajamas. You saw the meme that said, you know, it's summertime. Do I wear shorts or do I cut off my pajamas and make shorts? Everybody's living at home in their pajamas. Well, this guy's in his, it's sort of like the night garment, but he's not dressed. He's got the thing on in haste. And when the guys come, and by the way, when he left, they laid hold on him and he left the linen cloth. Here's the outer garment, the guy that lived in it is gone. So he's left the clothing empty of his occupant. And when he did, verse 52, he fled from them naked. He preferred the shame of public nakedness to being identified as a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. He was ashamed, willing to suffer public humiliation, nakedness, instead of being identified with the Lord Jesus Christ. So let me show him to you. Come back with me to the book of Amos, chapter 2. We studied about this guy when we studied the book of Amos. In Amos chapter 2, and I'm just going to start in verse 14 just so you get a little piece of the context. Amos 2:14, therefore the flight, shall perish from the swift, and the strong shall not strengthen his forces, and neither shall the mighty deliver himself. So the idea is there's trouble coming, and people that are fast are not going to be able to be fast, strong are going to be weak. Neither shall he that standeth, neither shall he that he stand that handleth the bow, and he that is swift of foot shall not deliver himself, neither shall he that rideth a horse deliver him. In other words, there's defeat. And when the battle comes and Israel's going to be defeated, and he that is courageous among the mighty shall flee away naked in that day. Well, there's the guy fleeing away naked in the day of defeat. Rather than being strong in the Lord, have the weak hand strengthened, they're going to give up. So what I think you're seeing there in that guy is right at the moment when the decision has to be made, we're going to fish or cut bait. We're going to say, we'll lose our life so we can save it. He says, not me. I'm hitting the road, Jack. And he flees away. And he seeks to save his life. But in doing it, he's willing to suffer the shame of public humiliation, the nakedness, rather than be associated as a follower of Jesus Christ. There's a true fellowship and a false fellowship. True followers and false followers. And what the cross did is it weeded out the mixed multitude. And what you're going to find with the failure of the 12, or the 11 of the 12, in spite of their failure, they were true followers. And that's what you'll see with Peter. And we'll get into that next time. Verse 40, 53, they led Jesus away to the high priest, and with him were assembled all the chief priests and the elders of the scribes. And Peter followed him afar off, even into the palace of the high priest. And he sat with the servants and warmed himself at the fire. When he says he followed afar off, we'll see this next time. It's Acts 2:38, 39, promises to you and as many as are far off. They'd been afar off. That's where he found Peter, was in the land of darkness. And he sat with the servants and warmed himself at the fire. But he followed. He's going to see it through to the end. And what happened is, after the resurrection, he saved his life. Okay. Anyway, you can just go home with a picture in your mind of the naked guy running across the parking lot. Ray Stevens wrote a song about that called The Streak. And his advice was, don't look, Ethel. But again, you guys, you know, you young whippersnappers have lost a lot of opportunity to be culturally advanced. Okay? Father, we thank you for your word and for the time we can spend in it. We thank you for the ministry that it gives to us and the encouragement that it can be to our hearts. We pray for our young people around this building that are being taught God's word and taught to love you. And we just pray that all these things might stick in their hearts, implant themselves in their hearts, and change their lives and give them guidance and strength to live for you day by day as it would do for us. And we thank you in Christ's name.